Hi everyone, welcome to another edition of Pele Yoetz. I've been on a little hiatus. Those of you who follow the broadcast and follow the channel, you know that my youngest son, Yair, is in the military, and he's just been sent off as of yesterday on like a pre-deployment deployment, which basically they're kind of getting him ready for Chas v'shalom. I really pray and hope that, you know, his orders will change. But if he goes to overseas, so he's doing all kinds of crazy things like jumping out of helicopters and all these things, you know, things that Imad does not want to know about. So we wish him the best. And actually this year is going to be in his zechus, for the zechus of Yair Mannuel, ben Devorah Esther, should have hatzlacha, should be safe. HaShem should bring you back in one piece. With stories that Ima will not faint over, you know, preferably. So today we're talking about grooming. Now, this, it's funny, you know, is it just me or do you get your mind boggled with some of the topics that come up in Judaism? But we have kind of heard, many of us, these almost like do as I say, you know, kind of remarks from the Rabbanim. And some of them have to do with hair, like, you know, long hair on your sons, and also nails in general for both men and women. But we've kind of never really gotten a full explanation as to why that is. But there is something to it. And this chapter, we're going to touch on that. So this is a very interesting chapter. And again, I think once you hear it, you probably will look at nails and long hair very differently. So let's get right into it. And it says, grooming is a part of honoring Shabbat and Yom Tov in order not to commence their observance when one is disheveled. According to the secret of the matter, the hairs are related to an aspect of strict justice. So who knew? Who knew that hair is attached with dinim? So it says, and it is proper to be very careful to groom every erev of Shabbat in order to not cause any harm to himself by giving power to, quote, the strangers to control him, chas v'shalom. One should also be careful to groom before midday because the afternoon is the time when the klipa becomes stronger. Therefore, we have heard a warning to be cautious in this matter on every erev Shabbat. So it's also good to know, this is why that afternoon prayer is so important. Not only because of this, but also, you know, that's when we're really getting to the thick of our day, right? We're really getting into it. And it is very easy to forget, you know, that we have a creator and we are his ambassadors here. So it says, if Rosh Chodesh falls on Erev Shabbat, one should groom on Thursday because risking any danger is more severe and one needs to be concerned about the will of Rabbi Yehuda Chehasid, who prohibited grooming on Rosh Chodesh. A person should be careful when he is grooming his hair on his beard to immediately shake off any hair that falls on his person. And again, this is also because that dinim is falling, it's attaching to you, so you have to make sure that it's all shaken off. This is in a place where there is a Jewish barber. One should not go to a non-Jewish one because the Kabbalist wrote that one who gets a haircut from a non-Jewish barber removes himself from the divine image. And we're going to talk about why that is in a second. So if you're in a neighborhood where Jewish barbers exist, you should go to the barbers, especially because they know how to cut the hair, for the reasons we're about to get into it. And this next sentence is actually in it's kind of in a paragraph, a parenthesis, and it says, this is the reason that I only get a haircut every 15 days, choosing the least of all evils. Even though there is a rectification, my heart hesitates. And this is the end of the parentheses. So it says that his rectification is to have this intention in the name of God. And he quotes the name, which I'm not going to say publicly. And it says he should recite the following before his haircut. And God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him, as quoted in Bereshit 1:27. After the haircut, he must wash his hands. So a netilat yadayim is what is usually done afterwards, again, because you're kind of touching these things that have had dinim attached to them. So you want to get this off of you as soon as possible. So it says, based on the source of this matter, one understands that those individuals who grow their older son's hair for beauty and good looks are not doing a good thing. For besides violating Devarim 22:5, a man should not wear the garment of a woman. There also is a need, according to the secret of the matters, that his hair should fall out unto the ground in order to remove the evil dominion from upon him. So again, you know, we think it's so stylish, you know, to have these little man buns. You see them everywhere now. They're like so popular, the man buns, and they don't even know, you know, the denim that is getting attached to them as a result to having this. So it says a person may allow his hair to grow during the days of the Omer, when according to the mysticism, it is proper not to get a haircut from Erev Pesach until Erev Shavuos. This is an inappropriate custom to follow in order to provide pleasantness for our Creator. I'm sorry, this is inappropriate. I think I said this is inappropriate, but this is an appropriate custom to follow in order to provide pleasantness for our Creator, on condition that a person states that he is doing it bli neder. This condition is proper to make for any good custom that one may keep. And the disciples of the Rizal wrote in Shari HaMitzvot Parshat Kedushim that at the time of the haircut, a person should intend that he is not allowing them to cut the sides of his head and the corners of his beard in order to fulfill the admonition of his Creator. By this, it is considered as if he filled the negative commandment in a positive way. And I am accustomed to reciting before haircut, for the sake of the unity of a Kadosh Baruch Hu and the Divine Presence, I am prepared to groom the hair of my head in honor of Shabbat, and I am prepared to be careful not to cut the corners of my beard in order to fulfill what the Torah said in Vayikra 19:27, do not cut the corners of your head and do not destroy the corners of your beard. Everything for the sake of providing gratification to our Creator, to reciting the matters in the root of the highest place. May the pleasantness of HaShem be upon us, etc. And God created man his image, and the image of God he created him. So we see here everything, literally everything we do, really there's a way to elevate this back. But again, who knew this, you know, about this dinim being attached onto the hair? So it says, it is proper for a God-fearing man not to cut his beard at all, neither on his face nor his neck, because he causes a great evil unto himself. In regards to his side locks, the peyot, it is good for every man to conduct himself in accordance with the opinion of the Rizal, to leave uncut the hair from his ears to the ends of his temples. This is a place of hair that extends beyond the forehead. It's the measure of its height. It's slightly above the height of the ear. So this kind of reminds me, you know, there's a section in the Gemara that really talks about, especially in Sneas, like it gets very technical and it almost sounds like a science class. And if you're interested in hearing that, you can kind of go over to, I have these, it's like a 3-part series and I think they're about 20 minutes each, and it's called Beyond the Curtain, exposing the hidden light of Sneas, and we kind of get into this, you know, very technical, you know, you cover from here and not to there and blah, blah, blah. So this kind of reminds me of this, and says, the measure of its height is slightly above the height of the ear. Why should not every man do this act of piety and similar ones? What effort does it demand and what monetary loss is there? These are very old matters and bear fruit in the upper realms. So again, very, I think really what he's trying to say in a nutshell is that this, it doesn't cost the man much to do. It really does help him, in the end. And really it's like, it's something that you think it's so simple. Yet again, it's one of those mitzvot that, you know, Lolina, we just keep trampling all over. And I think part of it is because we don't understand the consequences of when we're not doing this properly. It says, why would one not have pity on the honor of his maker in a matter that requires so little? Therefore, every man should conduct himself as if he were a Torah scholar and not be concerned with the scoffers who call him the sidelux of a sage. So it says, likewise, the trimming of one's nails is part of the honor of Shabbat, and a person should be careful to trim them every Erev Shabbat Kodesh, this either because of the honor Shabbat, or they are long enough that it is bothered by them, and they are a disturbance in regarding to the washing of hands. As a result, the blessing that he recites in the washing of the hands is in vain, and he has voided his fulfillment of the mitzvah of washing the hands, and he eats bread without truly washing. According to the secrets of the matter, the nails are also related to the aspect of strict justice, and a man should be very careful not to let the fingernails or toenails grow too long. This conduct is appropriate when a person goes to immerse himself for the sake of spiritual purity, so that the mitzvah is done correctly, and he checks himself for all possible ritual obstructions, like a woman who purifies herself for her husband. And additionally, one should be very careful to cut his nails in order to remove the hold of the klipot from him. And the custom of many people only to be careful regarding the fingernails is not good. And it is not good to be careful. I'm sorry. I'm going to get my act together, guys. I promise. It says, it is good to be careful not to cut them sequentially, even though the Arizal discounted this. In any case, he did not prohibit it. And why not satisfy the opinion of Avudoraham? So here we're talking about the nails. The nails seem to have the same ability to attract dinim onto a person. So a lot of times we hear the Rabbinim about, you know, keep your nails short, blah, blah, blah. And we just think they're just like raining on our parade and they don't want us to have fun. But lo and behold, it again, you know, I don't know why. Let's just do what they tell us, right? What's so hard about it? Let's just do what they tell us. But there's always got to be one. You ever notice that when the rabbis are trying to tell us, there's always got to be one that wants to fight about every single thing. I tend to just like, I'm going to do it. And I know Shem's going to bring the reason later. I just like, it just always happens that way. And for many people, not just myself, it just seems to happen that way. But little known fact as well, when you're cutting your nails, you know, pregnant women in particular, they have to be very careful, because if let's say one of them falls and they walk over it, it can be, has for shalom, it can really increase the chances of a miscarriage. So you have to be very careful, especially like when you're going to these nail salons and things of that nature. And just as a kosher 2.0 spin, if you are pregnant and you go to these salons, you also have to be careful, because if you're massaging towards the ankle, there is a trigger point there that attaches to the uterus and can cause contractions. So again, this whole aspect around, you know, the nail, you really have to be careful. It's really important, you know, how you're cutting them. Don't cut them, you know, thumb to forenail to middle to ring finger to pinky. You kind of cut them in all different kinds of order. So, you know, again, all these little things, who knew? So it says, there was opinion of Verdurum, who wrote that it is a cause for the bearing of one's sons in heaven, and heaven save us, in the saying of our sages in Nidah 17a. One who burns the nails is a pious person. One who buries them is a righteous person. And one who scatters them is a wicked person. So this is actually a well-known saying. This is a woman who is trimming her nails for ritual immersion, immersion purposes, must be extremely careful. And a person should be careful not to cut them over the clothes that he is wearing, nor over any clothing. Ritual slaughterers who need to grow their nails, and mourners, may we be all spared, should be careful to remove any dirt from beneath the cuticles and wash them each time, in order that the dirt should not be an obstruction when washing the hands for bread. As well, the dirt is repulsive to all who see it, and those with whom they eat are disgusted when they place their soiled hands into a bowl of food. Therefore, every man should be meticulous to be clean before Shem and Israel. So again, you know, this, another light bulb moment, who knew? You know, when you're not properly groomed, you know, all those times we're doing a netilat yadayim, we can be, it's like we're not doing it properly. We're saying that, and then we're saying the name in vain. And we haven't even washed our hands properly. So really, all, like I said, all things that I think will shift many people's perspective on, you know, I don't think that they'll look at man buns and long nails the same way again. I certainly don't need any more trouble than I get myself into. So this was really an eye-opening chapter for myself. And I have to say that I've been much more meticulous and careful about my grooming, especially of the nails. And it's funny because, you know, we're always being told there's, you know, two particular things we're washing more than anything, and that's the hands and the face. It's just weird. But klipot seem to be able to attach to things that are exposed. Another reason, you know, just to give a shameless plug for sneeze, one more reason why you really should be snewed. It's very easy for klipot to attach onto things that are exposed, but they also get trapped into the nails and into the hair. So really, really interesting, subject tonight. And I really am looking forward, and I pray that Hashem's going to give me the koach and the strength to keep doing this. I really enjoy it. And I enjoy being with all of you, and I hope we'll all be together again soon. Bezrat HaShem.